It is the 14th of January 2022. Welcome to the ninth lecture in the series of Lattice-Boltzmann methods. So for the remainder of the lectures, we come to some advanced topics. The topic of today is crit refinement. The content for this lecture is volumetric crit refinement, interpolation-based methods. We talk about scaling, and something that's pretty important, staggered versus aligned crit refinement. We'll see what this is. And another thing that's pretty important is the downsampling problem. This is pretty much related to the former. And in the end, we will talk about compact interpolation. So, just a brief motivation. Why do we need crit refinement in Lattice-Boltzmann? Lattice-Boltzmann in the industry is mainly used for external flow simulations. So in particular, simulations of cars. So measuring the track coefficient of cars. This is the main application of the Lattice-Boltzmann methods during the last 30 years or so. And what you basically have then is a kind of a wind tunnel. Yeah. So in this case, a numerical wind tunnel, yeah, where you have flow coming from this side, and you have an object in the flow, which, for example, could be a car, and you want to measure the track coefficient of this car. So this is the typical application. The track coefficient is, of course, related to the dissipation, and dissipation happens in the thin boundary layer that is on the surface of the object. So this is the place where all the action is. And here you need a high resolution to actually capture the dynamics, because the surface, boundary layer is thin. So you also need to have the result, the surroundings of the object. However, in the surroundings, the dynamics is usually pretty low. So there's not much dynamics in the surroundings, and here low resolution is sufficient. And of course, the cost of the simulation is strongly related to the resolution. So what you want to do is you want to have a high resolution at in the boundary layers, and you want to have a low resolution far away from the boundary layers. Yeah, this is what you want to do in order to have an efficient simulation. Okay, so far the motivation, and now we come to the first method that was already used 30 years ago. So this was the volumetric crit refinement. There's actually a patent on this. Volumetric crit refinement. So this is popular since the 80s, basically. So it's maybe 40 years already, 35. So it was popular mainly in the 20th century. Came a bit out of use lately. So, and it is using staggered crits. So what are staggered crits? You just see this. Okay. Let's say we have a coarse crit like this. So this is my coarse crit, and what I do is I define this here as a cell. So this is a node, this is a lattice node. And what these people did is they said, okay, it's not a node, it's a cell, yeah? And this cell, this cell can be split up into finer cells like this. So basically this is a coarse cell, and these guys here are fine. This would be a fine cell. So now what they did is pretty simple. They used something that they call explosion. So they need a communication between their coarse cells and their fine cells, and they did this by something that they call explosion. So they use this coarse cell and they split it up in two. If it's in two dimensions, there would be four. In three dimensions, there would be eight, of course. Eight fine cells. Oops, that look like this. I'm not trying beautifully today. Okay, I hope you see what I mean. So this is simply the communication from coarse to fine. So we translate a coarse cell to a fine cell, and we do this by saying that Fij, the distribution Fij of the fine cell, which I in this lecture will indicate by this F, of all the fine cells will be Fij of the coarse cell divided by 4. Yeah, so we just take all the distributions, yeah, we divide them by 4, and then we put all the same distributions in all 4 nodes, or in all 4 cells in this case. So this is the way we come from the coarse cell to a fine cell. So we can translate between coarse and fine cells, and the other way around, this is called collapse. So you collapse 4 cells, say they look like this. Let me see whether I can draw more beautifully. So you have 4 different cells. And you simply put all of them together to get to one coarse cell. And this you do by saying that Fij of the coarse cell is the sum over all these fine cells, say that they are, of course, now in two dimensions, there would be 4 of them in going in the same direction. So Fij coarse is the sum over Fij coarse of the cell N. So this is our fine to coarse translation. So then there would be two different ways you can simulate the two different resolutions in space, and then you also have to decide what is the resolution in time. So usually in most simulation methods, you have on all levels or for all cell types the same time stepping, but in Lattice-Boltzmann, together with the resolution of the grid, we also change the resolution of the time. And here we are using acoustic scaling, in particular in this volumetric version. So acoustic scaling is something that you should now already know. This is that delta x divided by delta t as a constant. And we see we split it up by a specific factor, namely that we say that the coarse grid spacing is two times the fine grid spacing, and this of course means that the coarse time step is equal to two times the fine time step. Yeah, so if there's one coarse time step, we do two fine time steps for the same time. So until now, I told you that the correct scaling for Lattice-Boltzmann is the diffusive scaling. Yeah, and now we are using the acoustic scaling. So you should wonder why this is. And then let us discuss this briefly. So why acoustic scaling here instead of diffusive scaling? So there's one publication, I believe, I don't know about more than one. One publication by a guy called Martin Rheinländer, who used diffusive scaling in grid refinement, but everybody else uses acoustic scaling. And I'm going to show you why, and because this is kind of a big... So I hope you excuse me that I'm using a prepared picture for this. So, because we saw that I don't draw beautifully. So why do we use acoustic scaling in grid refinement? So the point is that we know that the speed of sound in Lattice-Boltzmann is constant, or is given as, or say, speed of sound, CS, in Lattice-Boltzmann, is basically this square root 1/3 in dx by delta t. So speed, this would mean that the speed of sound in acoustic scaling, this is why it's called acoustic scaling, is constant, whereas when we use diffusive scaling, the speed of sound is not constant, which would mean that the speed of sound on the fine grid would be different from the speed of sound in the coarse grid. And now we have to apply some physics here. Yeah? If the speed of sound in two domains is not the same, what happens? So what happens is that the sound waves move according to the Snell-Descartes law. Yeah? And this says the following. So suppose there's a sound wave coming this way. So this red arrow is the direction of the incoming sound wave. And the sound wave hits the boundary between two areas with different speeds of sound, then there is a reflection of the speed of sound, or they actually, so the reflection occurs due to the bending of the speed of sound of the incident angle, yeah, that according to the Snell law is looking like this. So if we have this angle theta 1, so the speed of the sound wave is not coming normal to the surface, but at an angle, then the incoming angle and the outgoing angle, the sine of the incoming angle to the sine of the outgoing angle, this is related to the speed of sound. So the speed of sound on the fine crit divided by the speed of sound of the coarse crit, which according to diffusive scaling would be 1/2. So this means that at the surface, at the interface between these two resolutions, the sound wave would do a strange unphysical thing here. And if the incoming angle is flat enough, it would actually produce a reflection of the sound wave. Okay, so two areas with different sound waves, with different speed of sound, would result in reflections at the interface. This can be avoided if the speed of sound is the same, because then the sine of the incoming angle between the the ratio between the sine of the incoming and the outgoing angle is the ratio between the speed of sounds, which in acoustic scaling is the same, so this would be 1, and so the sound wave will just go through the interface. So this is now important, because it means that in acoustic scaling, we have no breaking wave, and no breaking sound wave, and this is of course something that we don't not want to have, and this is the reason why we have to use this acoustic scaling. So, okay, let's just write it down. Acoustic scaling at the crit interface to write properly. Avoids reflections . However, this also has some disadvantages, namely that when we use acoustic scaling, the equilibrium distribution and the non-equilibrium distribution require different scaling. By the way, this is, so we have to, yeah, we have to rescale. First of all, we have to rescale the relaxation rate. And the non-equilibrium distribution. By the way, this has not been done in the volumetric method, the rescaling of the non-equilibrium distribution. This is why it's also not used anymore nowadays. Okay, so let us look at this relaxation scaling. Relaxation rate scaling. how does this look like? So we have a viscosity nu, which should be the same on both sides of the grid, and we have this related to theta, which here is a constant, times 1 over our relaxation rate omega minus 1/2, and this into delta x squared by delta t squared. So now we see that both, if we scale these things, we get a different viscosity. So we want to have the same viscosity, of course. Yeah, viscosity is physics. Is physics, this has to be the same. So this means on both grids, where we have the coarse grid, so on the coarse grid we have an omega coarse minus 1/2, and we have a grid spacing coarse square divided by the time step coarse, and this is equal to theta. On the fine grids, we have an omega fine minus 1/2, and this goes into the grid spacing fine square divided by the time step fine. Okay, so now this can be solved for say 1 over omega fine. Yeah, so if we solve this for 1 over omega fine, we get delta x cos square divided by delta t cos times delta t fine divided by delta x fine square, and this into 1 over omega cos minus 1/2 plus 1/2. So this is this translation, and because we know that the coarse grid scaling is twice the fine grid scaling and the coarse time step is twice the fine time step, yeah, we can see that this here is equal to 2. And with this being equal to 2, it is of course clear that omega f is not the same as omega cos, yeah? So this has to be changed on the two grids. Okay, so far for the volumetric methods, just just some notes. So what is good about the volumetric methods? So let's say this is good. The good thing about the volumetric methods is that it is conservative. So it conserves mass and momentum. This is something that we like. Okay, so that's good. Everything else is bad. Everything else is bad. We have in this, we have a discontinuity. In pressure. This is something that would require a little bit more analysis to show this, but what is relatively clear that there's also discontinuity in stress. And this is also highly dissipative, which is not, I mean, which sometimes is positive because it helps stabilizing the method. So it's not easily going unstable. Yeah, something that is dissipative is wrong, but it's not unstable. So the problem, the main problem with all of this is that this x explosion methods. So what is the explosion method? Explosion method is that you take the same distribution that you have in the center of the node and you put it to all the new find nodes, yeah, and this is the explosion method, and this is an interpolation of zeroth order, because you just say, so what is an interpolation of zero order? Interpolation of zero order means you have your distributions here, and you're asking what are the distributions here, here, and here, and you just say, okay, they are the same. Yeah, so you just put the same thing here, and this is an interpolation of zero order. So for example, if you want to, interpolation of zero order would be, for example, you look yesterday, what was the incidence number of COVID cases in Braunschweig? And this was, I don't know, 500 or so. And then you say, okay, today is the same. Yeah. Today is the same is interpolation of zero order. And this is not sufficient for solving the Navier-Stokes equation. Yeah. So what interpolation order is actually required for solving the Navier-Stokes equation? So let's have a look. The Navier-Stokes equation. Yeah. So I write it here as in the form that in the asymptotic form. So we have the zero order of the density, and I'm writing here the Lagrangian time derivative, just to make life a little bit simpler. And we have here minus theta. Nabla of the rho of the first order plus rho zero order nu Laplace u1. Okay, maybe we could write this as a vector. So what do we have here? We have here first derivative of the density. So this means our interpolation has to capture the first derivative at least of the density, which means as a requirement that we need at least linear interpolation. So if you have less than linear interpolation, so less than an ansatz function that is at least related to x plus y, yeah, if you have less than linear interpolation, this derivative would always be zero. So it would always disappear. So for density, we need at least linear interpolation. And here we have a second derivative of the velocity. Because we have a second derivative of the velocity, we need at least quadratic interpolation. Otherwise, we are not compatible with the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay. But we have different requirements on density and on velocity. So, this is not, both is not done in the volumetric methods. It's not even linear interpolation. It's just zero order interpolation. So, and this is why this volumetric method is no longer popular, and instead nowadays we are using interpolation methods. Or say for the last 25 years we have been using interpolation methods. 25 years, so this means I can still talk about the classical methods. And this is classically done with overlapping grids. Sometimes even today, even though we better understand the problems that this causes. So classically implemented with overlapping grids. So previously I said that the volumetric methods used staggered grids. Staggered means that there is an offset between the grids, and overlapping grids means there is no offset between the grids. So say this is this is my coarse grid, and here on the other side I have a fine grid, which now starts here. It has twice the resolution. And this now has to have some connection. So in here, we have some overlap. So these nodes here, so for once we have these nodes that are in between two coarse nodes. These nodes require interpolation. And this kind of grid coupling also requires temporal interpolation, yeah, because we have delta t square is equal to 2 delta t, sorry, not delta t square, delta t cos is equal to 2 times delta t fine, yeah. We also need some temporal interpolation. In this method. Okay. So these guys need to be interpolated, and then of course the data has to be transferred. So we need to talk about the data transfer between these grids. Between the different resolutions. And this is done by splitting the pre-collision distribution into an equilibrium and a non-equilibrium part. And the reason for this is because they need different scaling. So the equilibrium part actually does not need scaling, but the non-equilibrium part requires scaling. Basically, we know that the distribution Fij is composed of Fij equilibrium, which of course we can compute, so we know this, and that we can subtract this and get Fij non-equilibrium. Yeah, so of course the way we compute this is we know Fij from Fij, we can compute Fij equilibrium, so we subtract this and we get the non-equilibrium part. And now we use our knowledge from the from Taylor expansion and asymptotic analysis, not expansion, expansion. So we know that the moments MAB, they are composed as MAB equilibrium. So I'm now putting everything in BGK format. In BGK form, we have here delta x divided by omega dx MA plus 1b plus dy MA b plus 1 plus terms of delta x square. So this guy here does not require any scaling. It's scale invariant. So we can just transfer it from one grid to the other. Here, because, here because there is delta x in it, this requires scaling. And this again, so we put the scaling part in here, so this would still be scale invariant. So, and due to this, we see that we have, so this is this all together. This all together is the non-equilibrium part, yeah? So the non-equilibrium part is are here the derivatives times delta x by omega, and delta x is scaled, so we have to, we obviously have to change this, and this is then done Fij, fine, must be Fij cos equilibrium, so equilibrium is always the same, plus now the scaled delta xf by delta by, sorry, that was wrong, by omega fine times omega cos by delta x cos times f cos non-equilibrium. So this is how we get the fine resolution and the coarse resolution. The other way around is Fij, the fine resolution equilibrium, plus the coarse delta x divided by omega c times omega f, so write it properly, omega f divided by delta x f non-equilibrium. And now you, of course, you have to put in the values for omega f that we got previously. So in principle, you could also so here what we are doing is we are scaling the pre-collision distribution. The pre-collision distribution is always the one that we write without the asterisk. There's also the possibility to use the post-collision distribution, but the pre-collision distribution is preferred, because if you do all the math on the post-collision distribution, you will recognize that there will be a singularity. I don't want to go too much into details on this. Could be something that you do at homework as a homework. So pre-collision scaling is preferred as post-collision scaling has a singularity at omega equal to 1. So this is why we prefer to do it in the pre-collision states. Okay, so this is the translation between the scaling of the distributions. What we have not yet talked about is the interpolation that we need, in particular the interpolation of the hanging nodes. So let me again draw some coarse grid here and say here we have the interface. So say this is the interface and here we have the fine grid going on. So, and say this here, this is a hanging node. So, this node, yeah, this doesn't has any, so the fine node here does not has any correspondent on the coarse grid. So this has to be interpolated. And the other ones, so these here, these are overlapping nodes. They still need to be interpolated in time, but they don't need interpolation in space. Okay, so what we said previously was that we need a quadratic ansatz function for the interpolation. So it's not enough to just take the two neighbors. But the interpolation requires a quadratic. So we need quadratic interpolation. How many points do we need if we want to have a quadratic interpolation? Somebody write this in the chat. How many points? Three. Yeah, three is correct. But what is the problem with three? If we take three nodes, so how would this look like? Let's draw it here. Say I want to go here. Okay, now I draw it on the grid. That's better. So I want to go here. Yeah, and I have a node here, and I have a node here. So in the next node would be here, and here. So if I use three, I do not have symmetry. So usually we also want to have symmetry, because not having symmetry makes a lot of trouble. And so we end up using four, not three. Yeah, we use one more. Okay, so this is the stencil that we use for the usual interpolation at the interface. And this is for the hanging nodes and the overlapping nodes. The overlapping loads apparently do not need interpolation in space. So this is important, apparently. So, you guess it, it's not true. Ah, yeah, no, and okay, there's something else I want to say, namely that we require no interpolation because we have this overlap. From fine to coarse. So you see that each coarse node has a corresponding fine node. Yeah? So there is no interpolation required to go to this, to go from the fine node to the coarse nodes, obviously. And this is regarded as an, or was originally, say 20 years ago, and still maybe 10 years ago still, was considered an advantage of overlapping crits. Over the staggered crits. So overlapping crits is the node is on the same the same position, and in the staggered crit they have some offset. Now, as it turned out, this was a big misunderstanding that caused a lot of trouble in the past, but is now resolved. So it's always important to mention these things so that in future people know not to make the... What is this here? That in future people do not make the same mistake. So I have here a picture from something like, it's now more than 10 years ago. So this is from, to write this here, in 2011. So it's not my picture. Okay, so this this interpolated overlapping crit refinement was very popular, as you see, 10 years ago or 11 years ago. This is more or less when we stopped using these things. And it caused certain trouble. So everything was fine as long as we were in the condition of laminar flow, but when we had turbulent flow, what we observe is by the transition from coarse to fine crits, we get these strange artifacts here. So where simply this is the velocity field where we have these velocity streaks here. So simply it didn't work, and it was apparently not very clear why it didn't work. And now we want to explain what is the problem if you have no interpolation between the from the fine to the coarse crit. Yeah, and this is okay, so this is something that we have to understand. Some discussion here, the so-called data downsampling. So So what is data downsampling? Yeah, you have a simulation on a fine grid, and you just want to say, okay, I want to have this on a coarser grid. So all you have to do is to throw half of the data out, and then you have it on the fine grid, right? There is a problem with this related to the so-called Shannon theorem or Nyquist theorem. Shannon, so the Shannon sampling, I hope you may have heard this. Theorem requires data to be so-called band limited. At half the sampling frequency. To avoid aliasing. So as it turned out, this problem that we had here in the grid refinement is actually something that is very well known in signal processing, yeah, where this problem is known for basically a century, and also how to avoid this. And this is related to the Fourier transform of our signal. So I hope that we go a little bit into signal processing here. Yeah, I do not know your background. So in principle, you should have heard this in some lectures. But if you are a civil engineer or so, you probably not. Yeah. So let us consider. Let's see. So consider the Fourier transform. Of discrete. So this is important. Yeah, we have discrete data. Discrete data points. And let's try to draw this. So say this here say these are the Fourier coefficients. So and say this is the absolute value of the Fourier coefficients, yeah, so the magnitude, and this here is the frequency. So then there is 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. So there is, of course, a sampling theory, a sampling frequency f. So f is now the frequency, f sampling on the fine grid. So this is the fine sampling. Yeah. And what's, let me see whether I've done this correctly. Yes. So this is the FSS is the sampling frequency on the fine grid. And then there is, of course, the sampling frequency on the coarse grid. And this is, of course, just half of it. Yeah, so this is half of it. So this is also FSF half is the same frequency. So what happens according to the Shannon theorem to discrete data in the Fourier space? So the thing that happens is that say this is my signal, so these are my data. These are my data, so data on the fine grid. The Fourier space of this data, because it's a discrete signal, is mirrored here, so there's a mirror image. This is mirror data. So you get this mirror image around the half frequency of the sampling. So this is according to the fine grid. Now, if we have in addition the sampling on the, or if we look at the sampling of the coarse grid, then everything in here, in this range down here, that is not zero, is reflected. So again, you get the same mirror image now here, yeah, around on the coarse grid, you get the mirror image of everything down here in your data range. So what you end up with in the data range is the sum between data and this mirror. And this looks exactly like your information. So this up here, so you cannot distinguish between these two things. So this is the apparent signal, and this has this aliasing problem. The aliasing problem means that data that is in the range that cannot be resolved by the coarse grid but has been resolved by the fine grid is now mirrored into this data range here in between this FSC 1/2, so to the lower frequencies. Okay, so for people working in signal processing, this is something that is pretty obvious. To people working in other parts, in other engineering sciences, this had been a problem to understand this, obviously. So let us write it down. So sampling produces spurious mirror images, or mirrored image, at half the sampling frequency. Which means that the signal at the frequency larger than half the sampling frequency cannot be distinguished from the mirror image of lower frequencies. What did I say? So that sentence doesn't make sense. So signals at frequency larger than the half the signal cannot be distinguished from the mirror image of cannot be distinguished from lower frequencies. So this requires a low pass filter. So question is, why is this not a problem on the fine grid? Well, this is not a problem on the fine grid because on the fine grid there is no data here. Yeah? So this doesn't belong to the data. So the signal is already going to zero. Before it hits the half frequency. But if we want to have it on the fine grid, so we have to make sure that there is no data here left. Yeah, because everything that is here left will go into our data range, and this will corrupt our result. And this means we have to low pass filter before we transfer from the fine grid to the coarse grid. Now, for a long time this was not a problem because in laminar flows, where this was of course first applied, laminar flows are often naturally band limited, so this means they do not have high frequency data, and if there is no high frequency data, then there is no aliasing. Yeah, so because what you're mirroring is just zero. However, in turbulent flows where you have data on all scales, they are not band limited. So the problem is this grid refinement method without filtering, this overlapping grid refinement method without filtering, worked pretty well in laminar flows, but it did not work with turbulent flows. And there is an interesting observation, even though this was not the motivation of the guys 30 years or so ago, when they used staggered grids, but at staggered grids you never had this problem, so staggered grids always work together with a turbulent flow. Staggered grids, so this is the volumetric method, they never had problems with so this comes from the automotive industry, basically. And they used it for turbulent flows and they never had this problem. And they never had to filter. They never had to use a low-pass filter. So what happens on staggered grids? Because staggered grids, they are not overlapping. You always have to interpolate all of them. All nodes are treated the same and they are all interpolated. And as it turns out, that interpolation, probably without even noticing that this is a solution to a problem that they didn't know, interpolation has a so-called low-pass characteristic. So if you use interpolation, you automatically filter the data, and this filter is sufficient to eliminate the high frequencies that you do not want to have in order to avoid aliasing. So if you use staggered grids, you automatically don't have this problem with the turbulent flow, and you can basically go without filtering. Okay, now having said all of this, we now finally come to the method that we are nowadays applying, and this is the so-called compact interpolation method. There are of course many others also, but in this lecture we are dealing only with one of them, compact interpolation. So what does this mean? So we have a problem. What is our problem? The problem is we need quadratic interpolation. And quadratic interpolation, as you saw, requires a large stencil. At the interface. So a large stencil means many points in the other grid are required . And of course, we always want to be efficient, so we want to have small stencils. So there's also a solution. There's a problem and there's a solution. We can reduce the stencil size with our knowledge on asymptotic analysis. This is one of the reasons why we had to learn this difficult mathematical thing. Asymptotic analysis. So asymptotic analysis will now come to good use. So say we have here again our coarse grid, and we want to put this into fine grid. So this is coarse to fine, and the other way around would be like this, fine to coarse. So, and we want to have a small stencil, so we just want to have the surrounding nodes. Now I misdrawn this, sorry, wanted to indicate it this way. So this is the so-called source node. This is where we get our information from which we want to interpolate. And we have a destination node. This is where we interpolate to. So, for the interpolation, we have some information. the information at the source of the interpolation, and this is, we have the density rho, we have velocity u, v, so in the different directions, and then we also have these moments m11 and m20 minus m02. Yeah? And here comes asymptotic analysis. Here comes the asymptotic analysis that tells us that m11 to second order minus m11 equilibrium to second order divided by rho to zero order is equal to 1 over to minus 1 over omega theta. And here now are the derivatives of the velocity, which is interesting. And also we have m20 second order minus m02 second order minus m20 equilibrium second order plus m02 equilibrium second order. All of this divided by rho zero order is equal to minus 2 omega theta dx u first order minus dy v first order. So this is the outcome of the asymptotic analysis, which we learned, of course, in lectures 4 to 6. Now we need a quadratic interpolation function. So this is a second order interpolation. Oh. And we need this for velocity. We do not need this for density, but we need it for velocity, as we said. And we specify this as u, x, and y. So this, we write this down in two dimensions, and we have the following ansatz. So we have coefficients that we have to look after, look for, is a0 plus, so there's a constant term, a term ax times x plus a y times y plus a x y times x y plus a x x times x square plus a y y into y square, and the same thing for the other velocity, where we write b. We write everything with b, xy, xy plus bxx, x square plus byy, y square. And for the density, we said that we that linear interpolation is sufficient. There's also a possibility to do this quadratically with the same data, but this requires a little bit more derivation, so we go with the simple version here. So this is a simple bilinear interpolation, and this bilinear interpolation, so this has four coefficients. So we have four source nodes. So with the four source nodes, we can derive all these four coefficients. However, in the case of the velocity, we have to get the information also from the higher order moment. So now we have four times four. So we have four nodes, and everywhere we have four data for the So we have 4 times 4, 4 moment, 16 moments for the velocity interpolation. So some of them are the velocity themselves, and some of them are derivatives. So on, they are on 4 nodes. But our interpolation function has only 12 coefficients, so we have more information than we need. If we do not need the derivatives, we have less information than we need. Now we have a overspecified system, and this means we have to also reduce data, and the way this has been done is the following. So there are different ways of doing this, but the one that we discuss now here is the following. We use finite differencing with a particular stencil to get rid of some data. And the stencil that we are using is looking like this, plus, minus, minus. So this is the Y stencil, and minus, plus, minus, plus. This is the X stencil. So which, yeah, so here are our nodes. And plus means we take the moment with a positive value, and minus means we're subtracting it. And these things now look like this, dx. So this is how we define our stencils on a particular quantity, and the quantity that we have is the moment m11, for example, dx, and this is equal to dx v dy u. So this is a second derivative of of the velocity, and if we put our ansatz function of our two ansatz function of the velocity and take this particular derivative, we end up with 2bxx plus axy, and dy, same thing, dxv plus dyu should be bxy plus 2ayy. So this gives us some function that we have to solve for getting the coefficients, the x. So the other moment, m20 minus m02, the same stencil applied on this, dxu, dyv. So this is basically the moment, and this should be 2axx minus bxy. So this is what we get if we take the second derivative of these ansatz functions. Dy dxu minus dy v is axy minus 2byy. So this gives us this additional information, and now we have enough information of getting all, so together with this and all the remaining coefficients from the velocity at the nodes. Of course, this is now a set of equations that has to be solved. But it has to be solved only once. You can use Mathematica, for example, or you can do it by hand if you like. So it has to be solved. Solve system. For the coefficients. Once you have the coefficients, you can simply apply them in the interpolation. So this is the basic procedure. How this is done, of course, you still have to write down the equation, solve the system, see how they look like, and then do the transfer with this. Of course, this also includes a lot of mathematics, but this is now basically the recipe that you have to follow to get to this actual point. Yeah, I don't want to write down the equations. Yeah, this is not helpful if you ever want to implement this really. Then you have to go to the original literature, or you do it with this recipe by hand, which is probably preferable. So having said all this, let's come to the actual algorithm of how grid refinement is implemented. And for this, let me draw here, say this is the fine grid. And here we have coarse grid nodes. So this is where we do the interpolation. How many do I need? So this is now my coarse grid. Okay, so we have here transition region between the coarse and the fine grid. And these things here that I've drawn here, these are interpolation cells going from fine to coarse. And from coarse to fine. Okay, so this is, let us assume this here is our step one. So all nodes are known. And now we have to proceed. Let me, in order for simplifying my life, I'm now going to copy this. Okay, let's say we have, so this is step one. So now we have step two. Step two means we have one fine time step. So if we have one fine time step, what happens is that all the fine nodes in this row here, they will become invalid because these outer line This outer line has no neighbors. And this is bad because in the streaming step, they do not get information from their neighbors. So what happens is that all of them become invalid in this first find time step. But all the other nodes are still valid. Okay? So we need two find time steps, as we said, we need two find time steps for one cause time step. So what happens in step 3? So this is now our find time step 2. Yeah, so this is find time step 1. So we do two find time steps. So we already saw that this year, these nodes are invalid because they didn't have neighbors. So they can do a collision, they can do a streaming, but after streaming, they are invalid. Yeah, because they do not have neighbors. So, which means they are basically, these guys are basically gone. So then in the next time step, this row here can still do its update, its collision, and it can do streaming, but it doesn't get new information from its neighbors because all the neighbors are dead. So in the second time step, these guys die, this guy also die. Okay, so now we have had two find time steps. After two find time steps, we do one cause time step. So we've already lost these nodes here. All of these nodes are dead. And now in the cause time step, also these guys step 4, this is the cause time step. And now all these nodes are invalid. However, we still have all the surrounding nodes. So what we can do next is in step 5, we do the interpolation. So we do the interpolation, and the interpolation means that, okay, what was previously dead is now interpolated from its surrounding nodes, and we get refilled, and this goes back to step 1. So what you see here is that you require a particular overlap in the region in order to be able to do the interpolation, but then it is not required, so no interpolation in time is required. So, speaking about time, we have another 20 seconds. So I guess I'm basically just in time. Is there, okay, I'll stop the recording. Oops, no, it was the wrong button, sorry.